Welcome back to Pixel Junkies. You are listening to the Pixel Junkies podcast, episode 16. I am one of your hosts, Rory DC.
I'm your other host down on the porch tonight.
I'm Aaron DeBagel Bishop.
That's the worst. It was better to not have a nickname.
No, that's official now.
It can't be.
It is official.
I'm Andrew.
We'll get you one.
So yeah, today we have a couple things to talk about. Actually, before we get started on anything, there was something that I kind of wanted to talk about, but rather indirectly.
There's a lot of spit on this microphone. It's gross.
That just means it's been well used.
It's broken.
Broken in, yeah. It has character.
It's patina.
Yeah, there you go.
So has there ever been this description for something that is like where this? Has there ever been something where the description "it's been well used" is like a really positive aspect?
Yes, but I can't think of anything.
I want to bring something up, but ideally we're going to pretend that it has no context and wasn't motivated by anything. All right, so
I don't know where you're going with this.
Yeah, so, don't worry.
Christianity.
Christianity, well used.
I am a huge fan of interviews, right? Uh-huh. I love interviews with people in the entertainment industry. I digest them like crazy. And I've even had the privilege to conduct a couple interviews in my day. So these
we had an interview last week, Rory.
We did, yeah. And we interviewed Matt Shea, and it was good. Those are my qualifications for talking about interviews.
This is actually the same day we all changed outfits. Well, we changed outfits. You guys stayed in the same clothes.
Matt Shea, you stay back there. You're not needed this episode.
If any of members of our audience are aspiring interviewers, if you ever intend to ask an interviewee, particularly someone in the entertainment industry, a personal question, you need two key ingredients. The first ingredient is you need an interview that is designed for it. There's a lot of things that go into that, but the primary thing is length, because you need to build in to those personal questions. And that sort of ties into ingredient two, which you need a transition, and you need to make that transition explicit to the person you're interviewing, so they know that there's a motivating factor to those personal questions. Mm-hmm. I don't know if any of you picked up on the context or motivating factor behind why I'm saying this. I don't know if any of you saw the video.
The riots in Baltimore?
No.
Was it the Detroit Lions got now out of the NHL playoffs?
No, it was the Robert Downey Jr. interview.
Oh, I thought you were going to go with like...
Was it the earthquakes in the
resumes ball? Are better well used approach. I don't know.
The what?
What happened with Robert Downey Jr.?
Yeah, so someone did an interview with him, and he walked out because they started asking personal questions. And to be clear, the interview wasn't an interview designed for personal questions. Like, the understanding is that it was a promotional interview for the new Avengers film, mm-hmm. and Robert Downey Jr. rightfully walked out, and also the guy
had... third question.
Yeah, and the guy had no build-in to those questions.
They were asking him stuff about, like, the Avengers... And then he answered two out of the three questions. Finally, the last one, wasn't it? Like, he didn't just get up and walk right out.
He gave the guy a chance to realize that what he was doing was not proper interviewing technique. The guy had no, like, context into switching into a personal question.
What did he ask?
Something about his incarceration history.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. And it was just like, no, like, what people forget... Often interviewers think, oh, I'm doing this for the audience. Don't forget that there's an individual in front of you, and you need to make it very clear to them why you're asking what you're asking. So they know that there's something to motivate those personal questions. It was, what you need, if you wanted to talk about that sort of thing with Robert Downey Jr., what you need is an agreement with him beforehand. Be like, hey, I'm going to ask you some of this stuff. You know, dude's a person, right?
Yeah.
You're going to need, like, 25, 30 minutes at least.
Yeah, I figured there'd be some sort of, like, build-up to, okay, thanks for sitting down with us. I'm going to be going through this, you know, is there anything you'd like to add or anything you'd like to redact? Like, is, you know, what do you...
Exactly, yeah.
Not just like, oh, hey, so how many days were you in prison? It's like, the hell, man.
Yeah, people ambush their interviewees way too often.
I feel like he took the political interview approach instead of the...
I know what you mean, yeah.
Yeah, just like ambush?
Not political interview approach.
This is the same guy who interviewed Tarantino and asked him about the movies and violence thing. I don't know if you remember that interview.
No.
Where Tarantino completely shut him down. It was just like... And I have sympathy because I conducted a bad interview once, which was totally my fault. It would not the same circumstances, but nonetheless.
You didn't interview Robert Downey Jr., though.
No, but I conducted an interview once where I totally screwed it up. I sympathize with the interviewer in that way. Bear that in mind if you're an aspiring interviewer and you want to do things. Those two key ingredients for personal questions.
Wasn't he the guy who asked Commander Shepard why he sacrificed human ships in order to save the Destiny Ascension?
I never did that.
No?
No. I did it once. Rory, how many days have you spent in prison?
Zero, no, actually. Just in case the audience thought that I was avoiding that question.
It's unimpressive.
So, anyway.
Enough to learn not to drop the soap.
Get that rope, you guys.
We sure do. So.
What should we do? Now, we've got a couple things to get through. Do we want to transition into me and Adam talking about Age of Ultron yet? Or do we want to save that for
later?
Let's
just get it out of the way. It's going to be a spoiler-free thing because nobody has seen it yet.
Yeah, but then everyone's going to be like...
Except these two losers.
Apparently, we got the last three seats in the theater because apparently Hits of M bought every other one.
We're recording this Friday.
And we saw it on Thursday.
Yes. Yeah.
They're invited to the red carpet premiere a month ago.
You guys dress up?
Absolutely not.
There's a couple ways we could do this. Adam is definitely going to have the more in-depth review on this one. So do you want to start or do you want me to start? How do you want to do this?
Spoiler-free.
All right, sure. You'll start. Yeah.
This is the worst thing I've ever seen.
I'm dreading this.
No, it wasn't. It was actually really good.
I don't want to know anything about it. Like, I don't even know what font the credits were written in.
Comic Sans.
Was it?
It's probably Ariel, actually.
Did it live up to what it should have been?
You might as well just leave. Just leave.
Do you want to leave?
Just no. Don't plug your ears. Leave. We'll signal for you to come back in, or I'll send you a text.
I'll deal with it.
Okay. I won't say anything too spoilerish, but everybody was. It was like the first one where everybody was given proper time. There was nobody who felt left out. So like. The side characters were given just enough screen time to make them seem effective, and all the Avengers and the villain were given enough screen time to like justify having all these people in the movie. He managed to do that by making this a very narrative and or not narrative sorry a character driven narrative much more than the first one, which was very plot driven. But this is all about the interactions of the Avengers, which is probably the best part of this movie, is just watching them talk to each other. The action was really good. The dialogue was really good. The acting is amazing. I can't really say anything else without like spoiling it and having Aaron, you know, Bagel over there have a hissy fit.
Did Ultron work as a villain?
Yes.
Okay.
Very well.
Cool.
I see what you meant by that question now after hearing it. I bet you meant like, I thought the question was like, is Ultron a villain?
Oh,
like does he
did
work?
Ultron function as a villain?
Yes, I know
he was asking. Yeah,
yeah,
I got it. I have one thing in particular to say.
Actually, before you get into your thing, I will say, going into this movie, there are a couple things that seem rushed, and I found out today that the original cut of this movie was 3.5 hours long, and the actual runtime of this movie is 2 hours and 22 minutes. So I'm hoping for a director's cut where they're going to include a lot more scenes.
That would be really good.
And hopefully that'll explain some stuff. It's nothing major.
I think they already came out and said the Blu-ray release is going to be the director's cut of the movie.
Sweet.
Why don't they just have movies that are 3.5 hours long?
Because nobody besides us would like it.
But there's already 3-hour movies.
Yeah, I don't know.
Whatever happened to having intermissions in movies?
I don't know. I guess people.
When movies were like 40 minutes long.
Yeah.
I guess people would just like
sit down for 10 minutes.
Well, because you know, people in the States would like the intermission would come. I was like, I guess it's time to leave. People just like leave and not come back for a second.
Intermission.
Half of the movie.
That must mean get the hell out.
It's not complicated. Go outside, kill a few people with your millions of guns, and then come back inside and watch a movie.
Make sure your cousin Cletus is looking at the screen.
Anyway, Rory.
Drive-by theater.
Right, so anyone who has, you know, read my reviews before knows that I do this thing, and it probably drives at least one or two readers nuts, where I refer to the performances and say one thing about them and don't mention anything else.
Mm-hmm.
because of what I always say, that, you know, they're one piece of the puzzle. I'm going to single out the performances in this movie. And in particular, I'm going to single out Scarlett Johansson's performance, which was phenomenal.
Your favorite performance?
Yes.
Mine was actually James Spader, but she was a close second.
Also, let me ask you,
how's her hair? Is her hair Captain America 2 hair or Avengers 1 hair?
It's closer to Avengers 1. It's actually kind of like a 1940s bob, almost like that kind of really, okay, really nice curly shortcut. Though. Yeah. Not super curly, but wavy.
I liked the way she looked, like the character looked in Avengers more than Captain America.
Yeah, no, okay, she's so definitely, she's probably the best she's looked.
Cool. She seemed like she had a very strong performance just because at the end of last week's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., they had a scene from the movie that wasn't, it was more like, here's a part of a scene rather than a full-on trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And even just from that, like, one-minute video, she had, like, a very prominent, like, role, even more than Captain America, who was also in that same scene.
Well, I mean, definitely. I mean, she takes a character which, under a less experienced and less practiced performer, could potentially be... but I mean, I'm singling out her performance in particular. With a performer that was less good, that could have been a kind of cold character. That could have been the only... trait that they decided to play up, but she takes a character whose, you know, primary trait often seems to be building walls between herself and other people, and she gives that role gravity, and she gives it emotionality.
That's always something that Joss Whedon has done, is he's been able to eke out, like, the best performance in his female roles and give them a very strong presence.
That's 100% true. I mean, she is easily, I think, one of the most, if not the most, charismatic actress on screen right now.
What about Captain America? Is he using his World War II costume again?
I don't know. It's kind of,
I think it's way to pay attention to the movie.
Okay, well, we were in the very front row and facing a tremendous screen, so I kept having to move my head back and forth just to watch it all. So
I had to close my eyes during parts of this movie.
So there were parts of this movie where I thought, this looks really bad. Not, like, because it looked really blurry, but I'm like, well, I am, like, 8 inches away from this, like, 80-foot screen. So presumably when I'm going again on Saturday with these guys.
Yeah.
So when we do that, we're going to be sitting in the very back rows. Hopefully that will improve it. I almost guarantee it will.
Oh, by the way, you guys have totally sold me on the sitting in the back
row
strategy.
You can lean back as much as you want.
It's much better.
Keep your feet up on
the only thing that's better about the front row is you can get up and just, like, go out and get, like, more butter for your popcorn or use the washroom or something without having it be a big hassle.
Yeah, but we sit on the edge, so it's not a huge hassle anyway.
No, you guys have sold me. It's the better way to watch movies. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back...
More about the Avengers, so stay tuned, everyone.
Oh, okay, yes.
What was that last thing... Never mind. Anyway...
All right, yeah.
That was a great start.
And we're back.
So, Avengers.
By the way, I liked it much more than the first one.
Really?
And I also liked it more than the first one. I actually really did enjoy the first one.
So did I. But I, like, the first one was, I thought I liked it, and it certainly accomplished about as much as it could have.
Cool.
But just taken as a unit.
Mm. Another Marvel movie that doesn't suffer from sequelitis. That's good to know.
I will say that this movie, you have to watch at least Avengers 1 to go see it. But I would recommend watching...
Not Captain America, Winter Soldier.
You can skip it. I know, because I skipped it.
Yeah. I would recommend watching it, because it's a good movie anyway. But it's not 100% necessary. If you read the wiki for Captain America, you're not going to miss much.
Okay. That's what I did.
Which is nice. But you honestly should watch it. It is really good.
Okay. Yeah, I'll give it a chance. I didn't watch it at the time because I disliked the first Captain America
so much.
It's
as close to another Avengers movie as there is ever.
It is. And it has the best fight scenes in any of the Marvel movies.
Yeah, even in, like, the first five.
And it has GSP.
Yeah.
For those who don't know,
apparently a much better actress than Ronda Rousey.
Former Canadian. Please don't hit me. Former two-time Canadian Athlete of the Year. Former mixed martial arts champion George St. Pierre is in Captain America the Winter Soldier.
Cool.
Miss Marshall Artist, who isn't either a jerk or B, you know, been kicked out of the league for running over some pregnant woman or getting involved in cocaine or...
Is he the bad guy that blew up in that movie?
He was involved in some sort of fight scene with Captain America.
He was the French... No, Algerian
one of, like,
pirate.
200 guys.
He was the Algerian pirate who stole the Luminium Star. And also, I went back and watched Avengers.
Did you not watch it?
For some reason, I'm picturing the pirate from Game of Thrones. Anyway, whatever.
Yeah, he's a mixed martial arts.
He's the guy that they beat up at the beginning on the boat.
Oh, okay.
He's the leader of those guys. I went back and watched the Avengers, and there's a scene where they're when they find out Loki's in the museum, the German museum, and he steals the guy's eyeball, and by steal I mean forcibly removes the guy's eyeball in the first Avengers movie. Mm-hmm. The guy who alerts Nick Fury to like that's happened is the guy who is like the Hydra dude, you know, the bald black dude with the glasses in Captain America 2, who's yeah. like they hold off the roof. That's the guy. So yeah, I don't know. So clearly, Joss liked his performance there and gave him another.
I think he was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as well.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah.
But yeah, so Avengers. James Spader did a very good job as this villain without giving away too much. It probably comes across in the trailer. I can say this because it comes across in the trailer. The guy's insane, or the robot's insane. Like he is not. He's probably the most psychotic villain I've ever seen. Maybe even including the Joker, because he does actually seem like just out of his mind in some places. But I think by far the best part of this movie is the interaction of the characters, because you get to see them interact in ways. It's kind of like, you know how in like Mass Effect 3, how like the best part of that game was Shepard just hanging out with his crew members?
Mm-hmm.
It's like that, where the best part of this movie, and there's a lot of good parts of this movie, is just the Avengers just kind of all hanging out together.
And it evolves the dynamics of the first one, but doesn't just rehash them. It's not just developments of dynamics from the first one. We get to see new dynamics emerge and grow, which was nice. It feels like a genuine sequel. It makes the sequel feel worthy of being. It's like, okay, there was a reason for this. Now we get to actually explore some new things.
Cool. Now, I read I'm not going to say that. I'll say that next week.
Okay.
Because that would be spoiler territory, although you could probably guess it from the trailers and the 1800.
Well, like, I'm getting too excited, so we have to move on. Excited for the movie. All right.
What do we want to do next? Do we have?
They mention Wakanda, and that's the first time they've mentioned the nation of Wakanda, and that's where Black Panther comes from. So they're setting up the Black Panther movie.
Okay.
And I'm pretty sure at some point they set up they do a setup for the next Thor movie as well. At one point during that movie.
Who would you get to play Black Panther?
Honestly, I said this way. Back when Iron Man 1 came out, and they were like, who would you get to play of these characters? I said Don Cheadle as Black Panther, because I really like Don Cheadle. Mm. Now he's War Machine, so I don't know.
Didn't they already have him cast?
They probably do.
I thought they did. Could be wrong, but
Power of the Internet.
Yeah. I forget the guy's name, don't know it. But I thought they already had him cast.
He was in Blood Diamond. What was his name?
Oh, that guy.
Yeah, that guy.
What? What's Blood Diamond? I forget.
Leonardo.
Chadwick Boseman.
Oh yeah, that guy.
I'm not. He was not in Blood Diamond. It's not that guy.
I was thinking of Bloodstone, the 007 game, for some reason.
Oh, and this is not spoiler at all, but the end credits scene for this movie is after the first credits, but before the second credits. So you don't have to wait like till the very end of the credits.
Oh, okay.
Because there's like the credits where it's like.
So there's. Captain America kind of did this too, though. There's definitely no extra scene at the very end.
Well, we didn't stay, but I don't think there is.
Well, we're staying.
We're staying. You should have stayed.
I mean, they might do the thing where that the Avengers did, where it was like a really intense scene at the end of the first credits, and then at the end of the second credits is them eating shawarma.
Captain America ended, had credits for a minute or so, and then it had the twins.
Yeah.
And then it had one scene after a little bit of credits, and then the actual credits, and then it had another scene at the very end.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
I think they said that there's not a post-credit scene, though. I think they came out and said the movie doesn't have a post-credit scene, but the Blu-ray release will. I don't know if that means it hasn't been filmed yet.
That's good.
We can fast forward through the credits then.
But there is one after the... So, like, the first credits are, like, it pans around, like, they pan around
this
thing where...
Nope.
He didn't want to know the font. He definitely doesn't want to know what happens in the credits.
I was just playing music in my head. I wasn't even.
We'll talk about it next week.
All right.
I got the guy's name up. I don't know how to pronounce it.
Chadwick Boseman.
That's definitely not Chadwick.
But wait, then you're not looking at the actor for Black Panther, because Black Panther is Chadwick Boseman.
Oh, he was cast.
Yeah.
This guy's name is like Dijon Horseradish or something.
Oh, no, that's...
Oh, no. No, that's
I know who you're thinking of.
No. Don't name your kid after mustard, I'm just saying. So, paid for mods got pulled from Steam.
They did. Good decision.
That didn't last very long.
No. At least they weren't racist about it.
Hey, man, I like mustard.
So, yeah, it was they had good intentions. It was poorly executed.
It was...
The whole system is...
I thought the whole thing was a disaster. I gotta be honest.
It was... The whole thing was a disaster. But I can see where they were coming from with, you know, giving payment to the people that are putting hundreds of hours into these.
Well, yeah, the intention, I guess. Like, the very basic intention was good. Everything after that was terrible.
I don't think they're done with it, to be honest. I think they're like, okay. Like, Steam pulled out way too quick for it to be done. I feel like they're like, all right, we'll stop it for now.
We'll go back to the drawing board on this one.
And we're coming back for round two on paid.
Well, they were losing more money from the server upkeep from all the emails they were getting than they were from the mods themselves. Like anything that is community managed, which these were, it was just chaos. There were. It's much like Steam Greenlight, where you get these really bad games being released.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Steam Greenlight's an absolute disaster.
Just to see a quick
bug. I know how to fix it. And Valve, Gabe, I know you're watching.
I know you watch every episode.
Yeah.
But we're speaking to the little
He's
man
that
here
one
now.
Guy who keeps liking our videos.
Yeah,
that's actually me.
Oh.
Have every mod be free. The creator doesn't have a choice in how much it's worth.
Well, donate button. That's how you fix it.
But you can say, yeah, have a donate button or like pledge to this mod or whatever. And you can give them whatever you want. It can be free. It can be a cent. It can be $10. It can be $100. And then they could organize the mods based on average price paid. So like average price, $5, $5.67 or $2.74 or whatever. And it would just show you what the average price people pay for the mod. You don't need to pay it, but this is what most people will pay. And then you could organize them like that. Like the most expensive mods are on the top, and then it goes down to free mods, so that it's more likely that you'll buy a mod because the paid for ones are at the top. The quality's at the top because people are willing to donate to it.
Yeah.
And you don't really want to be like, you know, that guy who just like, oh, I'm gonna get it for free, and then you feel bad.
But I mean, it's already that way in terms of best rating. Like you can organize all these things by best rating.
I just don't think there's a proper like. Secure feeling system with the quality of Steam where they could have, you know, make the pay button bigger, make it more prominent.
Well,
you know?
I think if they're really serious about, you know, getting money for these things, they should make it so you have to go through the donation screen before you can actually subscribe to the thing. So you hit subscribe and then the window opens up, you know, subscribe or donate, whatever. Hmm. Yeah. And then you have to choose one of those.
Right.
You subscribe for free or donate to this guy.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can just go back and be like, hey, I like your mod.
Yeah.
Like if you download it for free, I like your mod. Here's a couple bucks.
And sure. Again, Humble Bundle approach where when you buy it, you get to pick where the money goes. Like this much to the developer, this much to Humble Bundle, this much to charity.
Humble Bundle's so good.
Yeah. Like why don't they just adopt that model exactly?
Yeah. Can't say enough good things about those.
I don't want to give Bethesda 75% of the money I'm giving this guy who made every asset in this mod. Like, you know, I know it's their game, but he made everything.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's not entirely different than. Well, it is completely different in some ways, but it's similar to like YouTube commentary, right? If you do YouTube commentary, sure, you're taking someone else's game, but you're adding content onto it, and you know. Even more so with mods.
And that's what people want in a YouTube video. It's not necessarily the game most of the time. It's their interaction and their reaction to it.
And the money that like YouTube partners make, none of it goes to Bethesda. You could do an all Bethesda game channel if you wanted to. But none of it goes to Bethesda. It all goes...
Yeah, well, some of it goes to Nintendo, though.
Well, there's that case of it, yeah.
But, you know, it's weird because the YouTube market just sort of came out of nowhere and said, like, we're making money off this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it's our video. And then game developers were like, okay. But now it's like, oh, I want to make a mod. I drew all these textures by hand. I got, you know, I paid someone to do voice acting for me. You know, I put all this stuff together and compiled it, and now 75% of it's going to Bethesda. It's like...
Well, it was 45, I think.
45 and 30 to Steam.
Yeah, exactly. So you're making nothing. Yeah, 75% going elsewhere.
Yeah. So I think you should be able to pick, like, you know, I want the money going to Bethesda, or I want the money going to this guy. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They had a good idea about incentivizing people to start making mods, though. I mean, yeah, they came out with stats like less than 1% of their audience has ever made a mod.
Mm-hmm.
And making a mod is you know,
it's hard work,
and it's, well, really, it's one of the few ways to reliably get into the industry.
Yes,
as a programmer,
exactly. Yeah.
Well,
yeah. Without a background of doing it already.
Yeah, without a background in game design already.
It's like, if you want to apply to a game company, it's like you need to have like 5 years experience in.
Oh yeah.
The old school way of like starting in like the QA department and working your way up. I mean, it still works to a certain extent.
If you're a programmer, if you've never made anything before, if you don't have anything in your resume that.
Yeah, they're not going to hire you. And they have no reason to. They shouldn't, in fact.
They probably won't even read your resume. Like, there's a game company in town, and you like. Even if you want to just go down and visit them, they won't even open the door for you.
Yeah, well, it's that's
like,
the...
Can I talk to somebody? Yeah. Like, no, sorry, go away.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
I can't even give you my resume.
That one you're talking to about is, yeah, that they're a particularly picky one. There's a few game companies.
I couldn't even get in for an interview. Like, I just wanted to be like, hey, you got a new game coming out. Can I interview you for the Muse? And they're like, nope.
Yeah, he wanted to conduct an interview. He didn't even want a job interview. He just wanted to conduct an interview.
They must get a lot of,
well, can I see your resume?
Being downtown, they must get a lot of, like, crazy people that are just like, hey, you should do this. Like, oh my God, go away.
Yeah.
We're a game company. We don't need your free ideas.
He closed the door and was like,
That's a good idea.
Did you hear that? Write it down.
I wanna just finish on the mods. A big problem I had with the whole thing is the fact that it was Workshop-based. So Workshop, have you ever used the Steam Workshop for anything? Either of you?
Never the Steam Workshop, Aaron has. No.
So Workshop allows for basically zero customization. So you subscribe to the mod and it auto-updates. It automatically installs to your game, whatever. It's easy to use. You just one click, it's done.
Sure, yeah.
However, there's no real way for you to go in and modify anything, really. You can open up a mod manager and go in and move stuff around that way. But it automatically updates every time an update for the mod is released.
Mm-hmm.
Which means if it's updated and it's incompatible with something, there's not much you can do about it.
Right, okay, yeah.
There's no way, at least last time I used it, there's no way to lock it at a certain version to ensure that it's compatible as much as possible. So I never use Workshop for that reason. I always use other sources and load my mods through a manager, and that way I have a list of everything and I can customize it as much as I want.
Yeah.
So big issue with the whole paid mods thing is you've released paid mods on the least reliable system possible.
Yeah, you pay and then you get less customization as a result.
Less security.
Yeah. there's that as well.
No security, no way to manage anything.
Mm-hmm.
That was the reason they removed the ability for the uploaders or the modding community to remove the mod, because if somebody would pay $10 for a mod and then all of a sudden it's gone, it's like, well, there goes my $10.
Yeah.
If they just had the ability to, like, you download the mod or you hit subscribe, it downloads, and then it's there, then, like, you should just be able to keep it. If they remove the mod, you still have that file.
Right, yeah.
Or it could say, like, next time you boot up the game, like, there's a new version of this mod available. Would you like to install it? And be like, yes or no. Mm-hmm. You know, then you could install it. Then you have a new version or whatever.
You don't.
Sure, yeah.
Like, it would be fixed if you could, like, in the workshop, you could download the mod and it would be in its own, like, zip file or something.
Yeah.
Instead, you subscribe and it puts those files directly into your game directory.
Right, I see, yeah.
And from there, it's hard to move around. Like, you can unsubscribe from the mod and delete it, and it'll delete those files. But if you're still trying to organize anything, you still got to go in and look at those loose files in the game directory.
Yeah, they can be anywhere.
So it'd be much more appropriate, I think, if you could choose to download just a zip file of all those files.
Sure, yeah.
And from there, you can put it into a mod manager and organize it that way.
Mm. I wish they'd just organize the directories of the game better so that, like, if you subscribe to mods on Steam, you just go into your Steam directory, and then it says, like, mods, and it's just listed in folders, and you can just go into each one, look at all the assets.
Right,
you know, yeah. And then if you unsubscribe or if they remove the mod, you still have that folder there that you can do whatever you want to.
Sure, right. Yeah.
I don't know why they don't do that. It's very much like that if you use something I use called Mod Organizer.
Mm-hmm.
It's only for Bethesda games. It only works for Bethesda games. What it does is create a fake directory for the game. So as long as you're using this program, like you leave your actual game directory alone,
mm-hmm.
but it'll use this fake one to load all the mods as well.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So once you install your game, once you install your game originally, you never have to worry about that directory again, because no matter how many mods you load or how much configuration involved, you never screw up that directory.
Right, yeah.
It's all done in this fake one.
Oh.
So.
I quite like that. Yeah. And we're going to take a quick break down. When we come back, we're going to find out what Adam was going to say. And we are back on the Pixel Junkies podcast, episode 16. Now, before the break, Adam was going to say something.
Why does Batman Arkham Knight have a $40 season pass? Isn't that like
because really Warner Brothers are stupid?
Is it?
Yep. Is Rory, it Warner Brothers? What else is happening in the industry? No, I'm joking. It's a really dumb move.
I mean, that's the price of Majora's Mask on the 3DS.
Black Ops 3 did you say it's a $40 season pass?
Yeah.
On top of the price of the game.
Yep. Yeah.
So how much are you saving by not getting or by getting the season pass?
Not a lot, because I'm not going to
get
everything
on the season. You're saving negative $40.
What do you get with the season pass? It's a single player game.
If you bought whatever the hell is in that pack.
They're introducing new villains. They're introducing new skins. They're introducing new missions.
I gotta say,
they're releasing three quarters of a game and making us pay again for the other 25%.
I'm very tempted to not buy it and wait a year for the Game of the Year edition with all of that stuff included for $60.
I will be this stuff.
I'm gonna wait for a bunch of reviews before I run out.
This is unbelievable behavior. This shows why we don't expect enough from game companies. That they won't even release us the full game right away.
Yeah.
They have all this stuff. You can get it, but you have to pay another $40. By the way,
everybody complains about this stuff, but they still buy it. That's why game companies do it.
Oh, no, absolutely.
If people stopped paying money for this stuff, game companies would stop doing it.
And $40. I bought three games the other day for $18.
Yeah.
$18. One of them was Max Payne 3.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I promise you that the content of Max Payne 3 is more significant than the content of a few extra skins and some new villains.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
I would argue Max Payne 3 is a better game than any of the Batman games. As great as they are, Max Payne 3 is on my top 10.
Well, Max Payne 3 is really good.
It's in my top 10 list of all time.
It seemed like I would only ever... The only Batman DLC I ever bought was the Harley Quinn side missions.
Mm.
Or the Harley Quinn mission in
Arkham. I bought all that too. Have never played it.
I would go back and play the Harley Quinn.
I bought all of the DLC.
The plan is to eventually play it all, but
I bought the DLC for all the games, and I thought it was good, but
$40 good.
Yeah, what? Not even close to $40 good.
Yeah,
$4 is that how much good, it was? Maybe.
No, I don't know how much it was.
It wasn't even close.
It's probably not a good comparison because we don't know what exactly.
Because I bought the Game of the Year editions, right? I bought
that came with it, didn't it?
I bought them all.
This kind of brings up another question: if you're paying $40 for stuff you don't even know is going to be released, they're giving you vague ideas of what you're going to get.
Yeah, that's why.
Like, if you want my $40, explain to me what I'm getting.
Remember when they did the Watch Dogs DLC and you had to get a spreadsheet to look at what you would get in each
package? That was for the
pre-order bonuses. Sorry,
yeah, the versions of the games,
and then they made an even worse one with Evolve.
Yeah.
But
nobody bought Evolve or plays Evolve, so nobody cares. Well, about
yeah, I can't
a lot
imagine
of people
what
played
it must
the
be
beta,
like.
So they're like, "That's enough for me. Nothing's different about the full game."
Yeah. I can't imagine what it must be like for somebody going in, getting into Evolve now, and having like, why isn't nobody playing? Why can't I find a
Who developed that game? Who made
Turtle
it?
Turtle Rock. It was guys. It was a new studio by guys who left Valve.
They
worked on Left 4 Dead.
I think they downgraded a little bit.
Really?
There.
Left 4 Dead never had much in it anyway.
No, but it had like
four levels. Go kill your guys.
It had good gameplay. That's what sold Left 4
Well,
Dead.
Well, so
that
did,
was immediately
it wasn't broken.
Like yeah, it wasn't a broken game. Yeah, it worked well.
That's the thing. So few games work
it
now.
It's a $60
like,
game, though.
But that, like, non... I won't even review a broken game because I don't know what to say about it. It's not a game. How am I supposed to give it a
game? I think
you
should absolutely review broken games and straight up say, this thing does not work. Don't buy it.
Right. Well, yeah, I think that's the ultimately... Yeah, no matter how good, like, certain things of a broken game... Broken game can have the best narrative ever. Yeah. If it's broken, I cannot possibly recommend it. It's not a game.
Yeah.
By definition, games are playable. That's what the word game, to be played.
Like, yeah.
Yep.
What were you going to say?
I was going to say, take your $40 and go out and buy Arkham Asylum, Arkham City, and Arkham Origins, because you can probably get all three of those games
for really.
Game of the Year editions at that.
Yeah, for $40. You can definitely get the first two for under 40, you know, both together for under 40 bucks. And if you look, you know, well enough, you could probably get the Arkham Origins as well.
They were on sale recently, too, weren't they?
They were, yeah.
So, do that. Don't get the season pass. I bought
thing
one.
Is, hardcore fans are going to pay the $40 for this stuff.
Yeah, well, hardcore... I mean, I'm a hardcore fan of Halo, but, like... And they did just announce the Halo 5... that there is going to be a Halo 5 Xbox One bundle. But, like, I'm getting an Xbox because I really want to get Halo 5.
Right.
But, like, I don't know if I want to pay so much money for this bundle because I don't know if it's going to be... If Halo 5, because I haven't heard. I want to see some gameplay from Halo 5 first and learn a bit more about it at E3, because presumably they're going to show it at E3.
But you're definitely going to get it, even if it is terrible.
What, right? the Halo 5?
Halo 5.
Yeah, but I'm not going to get any of the special editions or the special edition.
No. Does the bundle even come with a special edition? Because every bundle they've ever done has come with the standard. I'm pretty sure.
No, but like that's what I mean. I won't get the bundle. I won't get like the special edition console, and then so I'll just get the regular console. And I won't get the.
Is the console more expensive?
I don't think so.
Or is it just the console that comes with the game?
I think it's just the console that comes with the game. I can't imagine it would be anything.
They should just have. That special edition console with the game be the same price as a regular Xbox.
Yeah.
Dead Island 2 got a delay.
Yeah, till 2016.
Again,
nobody cared.
Yeah. Better delay it than release broken.
And you know why nobody cared? Because Dead Light came out. Was it Dead Light?
Dying Light.
Dying Light came out. And
no one cares about it.
Well, I mean, but Dying Light is infinitely better than Dead Island was. It was basically what Dead Island should have been.
Yeah, Dying Light looks
What happens to
like
all those games?
Huh?
Like, those games, like, they released the initial trailer, and you're like, this looks really fun. And then, like, 2 years go by, and it comes out, and you're like, I don't care anymore.
Well, here's the thing.
Sunset Overdrive Syndrome?
Sunset Overdrive is actually a really fun game. It's very repetitive. That's its problem.
Yeah, but I mean, like, there was a lot of hype before it was released, and then it got released. And so, yeah.
It's like Titanfall.
Titanfall is also a really fun game. Yeah. There's just it's very limited on content.
But both Titanfall and Sunset Overdrive, and if you want a PlayStation 4 example, I don't know, like
this doesn't have PS4.
Well,
let's be honest.
1866.
Yeah, 1866. They're 18, all probably
whatever.
Good games for what they are. Repetitive. You know, they're probably repetitive, and so if you like that kind of repetitive, you know, if you like that particular gameplay, it's fun, but wait for a price drop, wait or for a recycled copy and then buy that.
The order's got to be down to, like, $4
if
now,
not.
Right?
I went into the store last night, I think it's still at, like, 50, 60.
Who made
it? Wow.
For a recycled copy.
Ready at Dawn.
Will that ever come out on PC?
No, it's Sony.
No, definitely open. Not.
Don't. Why would you even get it on PC? Why would you even?
Because then I could get 60 frames a second.
Imagine how good that. But think of how great that looked on the PS4. Imagine that game on the PC.
Imagine it running properly. Yeah. It'd be great.
Yeah. I imagine it would turn your PC into hot slag because it could barely run on. From what I heard on the PlayStation 4,
it ran great.
What are you talking about?
Beautiful
Adam?
On
it
the
was
PS4.
It was an aesthetic choice.
Although I'll admit, like,
just because it barely runs on a PS4 does not mean it will barely run on a PC, though.
No, but I'm just saying, like Unity barely ran on a PS4. Apparently, it would not run.
I got a pretty steady 60 on my PC.
Oh, but did you? I've heard mixed things about the PC.
It's definitely buggy, but you can Like, it looks a lot better than on PS4 on my PC, and it runs a lot better, too.
I won't be ever getting that game, so it doesn't matter.
No. Yeah, I won't.
I'm done with Assassins.
I won't get Unity, and I probably won't get The Order 1886. Well, I just hate cover mechanics at this point. I just hate
them. I don't mind them. It's just your game has to... Yahtzee said it best. He said, you know that thing where, like, your game has cover mechanics and it's a third-person shooter? Yeah, that can't be your only thing in the game. It has to have something else. Yeah.
I'd just rather a more developed environment where I had multiple places where I could strategically take cover as opposed to having to press R1 so my guy can, like, line his spine up against the wall.
Yeah. It was really bad in... I did like this game, but I thought it was really noticeable in... games like Mass Effect, for as much as I like that game, and The Last of Us, where you'd be walking along and all of a sudden, oh look, there's a bunch of chest-high walls here. Everyone get ready for a firefight, and they'd be like, ha-ha, we've surprised you. I'm like, no. See, I got tipped off by all the chest-high walls.
My favorite was Mass Effect 2, when the cover literally comes out of the ground before the firefight.
Yeah.
Mass Effect, the game that taught me that just because your graphics are really good does not mean your animation is really good.
Some guy in a control booth like, oh.
It happens in Gears of War as well.
Yeah, Gears of War is probably the... Gears of War really...
That might
really,
be the worst offender of mechanics for things you could do yourself.
I hate Gears of War. Really? I absolutely hate Gears of War. I hate the voice acting, and I absolutely love John DiMaggio, but I hate his direction in Gears of War, because...
How many of them did you play?
I played 1, 2, and 3. Okay. I've not played Judgment.
Neither have I.
And I've beaten all three of them as well.
You did? I enjoyed 2 and 3.
They're so short, and they just look so dreary.
Well, yeah.
Very brown.
But that's the style.
Tinted.
I guess, but I mean, like, they could have brightened it up a little bit, and it's just like... I don't know, I feel like it's a little bit too... I don't know, I just don't like the controls and the shooting. I feel like the guns don't have enough weight behind them.
Mm.
And
it also has Crisis Clunky Syndrome, which is what I refer to the clunky protagonists, like, found in some of the console versions for Crisis.
Yeah.
Where it feels like you're running around with a dumpster on your back. And then you sprint, and you sprint at, like, a million miles an hour.
Yeah.
Yeah, I always hate, like, in a game where they have, like, the gun bobbing. When you're running, but your guy's barely moving and the gun's going like this. Like, why are you... looks really bad.
I don't like the opposite as well, where you're moving way too fast, but there's almost no gun movement.
Oh, okay. I like that in if they're trying to pull off, like, an old-school shooter, like,
it's just like the
game.
The gun just goes up and down, like, what that one spot.
Yeah, I can see if, like, you're doing, like, leaps and bounds moving fast.
Yeah.
But if you can audibly hear the footsteps, like... And your gun moves, like, very slowly.
Yeah.
That's dumb.
As much as I love the game, I love Batman Arkham Asylum. I did literally everything you can do in it, I think, in the single player. But it really throws me off the way Batman runs. It's weird.
Yeah, it's very, like...
It's really, rigid. Like, narrow.
There's in Mass Effect, which, you know, Rory's already brought up, there are some animations that look really good, and then there are other animations that look absolutely awful.
It's because any still photo of Mass Effect looks amazing, and then you see the moving video, and it's like, oh.
Yeah.
Mass Effect's phenomenal, don't get me wrong.
It's a shame they reuse a lot of those animations for the...
Mass Effect 3?
For all the Mass Effect games.
Yeah.
All the Dragon Age games, too.
Yeah.
They reuse all those dialogue animations over and over and over.
Do you think at some point somebody at BioWare is going to be like... Like, hey guys, I saw something over the weekend you should see. So what? It's this movie called Lord of the Rings. Check out this Gollum character. He's using something called a 3D motion capture scene.
Yeah. They use it in The Old Republic, too.
Delete everything. We're starting again.
But after the 70th time, you see, like, the kind of head turn, or... Like, when they turn to leave, they do the...
They do, like, the...
Yeah. It got really bad. There's a couple parts in Mass Effect 3 that glitch out for me, because there's a part in one of the cutscenes in the Omega DLC. And Mass Effect is a game that did DLC, right, where they released the game, and then, like, 7 months later, they came out with DLC. They're like, yeah, we had some people at the office who weren't really doing anything, so we're like, make another story mission. And, you know, they actually made story missions, but you absolutely do not need them, because they weren't on the disc, and, you know, you don't need them. But there's a bit in the Omega DLC where
Arya Tolok is giving this speech, and the camera keeps panning over, but when it when the camera jumps to another spot on the stage, she's not there yet, so you see her having her go, woo, like, whoop, and she just, like, slots around. It's hilarious. And then there are times where she moves before the camera moves, so it's like, she's standing here, the camera's here, and then she'll go, whoop, and she'll face this way, and then the camera will, like, cut to here.
Yeah, it's hilarious. I always love that, like, the one frame in between when the camera cuts to something else, they move the actors.
Yeah.
So it's just like you see like an actor shoot off screen right before the camera changes.
But it's not even like a second before. It's just like whoop, and then like. It's pretty funny. There was also a time Mass Effect had some hilarious bugs, because there was one time where I came out of the galaxy map, my character was standing in the middle of it.
Yeah.
I couldn't get out, so I kept being like, Kelly, help me! Help me, Commander Shepard! I had to restart the game. I lost an hour of save progress. What's the best glitch you've ever seen in a game?
Swing like, set glitch in GTA 4.
Yeah?
Skyrim. I started a new game, and the... You know, where you're on the cart going into Helgen.
Yeah.
The horses and the carts flew off into the sky and started doing, like, spins and everything.
Yeah, my favorite
We never did get to Helgen.
Made it back to Cyrodiil.
My dad's copy of Fallout 3 has a lot of problems, and one of them is characters who are supposed to be fixed in a city not being fixed, and they just, like, go out wandering. So you'd be like in the far north of the wasteland, you'll see Lucas Sims, Sheriff of Megaton. What's going on? Like, there's no problem. What's just all the characters just,
you left the city?
They all leave. Oh. All the characters in my dad's Fallout 3 just took off from their cities. It'd be great basically. If, like,
he just wandered so far, he got to the edge of the map, and it killed him for going too far. And he's just like, Lucas Sims is dead. Like, what? I can't do his quest now.
I think the most hilarious one for me was in it was in Skyrim, where I saw a saber-toothed cat trying to take on a mammoth, so a giant came over and hit him, and he shot off at 100 kilometers an hour, perfectly perpendicular to the ground for a kilometer, and then, so watching it, so I was like, meow, meow, and he shot up at a 90-degree angle, and I just lost my
mind. I think that's because he does so much damage in Skyrim, and the damage system in Skyrim... Any damage you do beyond the point of death is converted into kinetic energy, it seems. So he's doing so much damage, and he overkills him so much. All that damage is
But it was just so turned funny into to force, see him go, and like, he flies like off. 90 kilometers like, perpendicular to the ground, and he shot up into the air.
As I recall, I had some problems with... And one guy online has a really good video of this. The issue with the player collision in Dishonored, where he, like jumps down and bumps into the person he's supposed to be rescuing. She was flying out the window. I had one of those, I think, where I like accidentally bumped into a guard and he just went flying over the edge of the wharf and into the ocean. I was like, oops.
I gotta play through that game again.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah, that reminded me of something the other day. I was watching one of our videos from a while back, and I think we talked about doing a supernatural Assassin's Creed game. And when I was watching, I was like, that's Dishonored.
Yeah.
It's funny, because I'm pretty sure we did that video post-Dishonored.
Yeah, yeah.
There's this thing in games that I've noticed, particularly when I was playing Thief. Games that are designed around one, like, soul mechanic are often, or, like, one soul idea are often less good at that idea than other games. Like, in Thief, it's less fun to be a thief than it is to be a thief in Skyrim.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think...
Interesting fact, the person behind the stealth mechanics in Oblivion, and therefore Skyrim...
Right, yeah.
...was the guy behind the stealth in the original Thief games.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
At least Deadly Shadows, I think. Right, I could be making this up completely. I read this somewhere, though.
If that's true, that's a good pattern, because he's obviously very good at that.
Yeah.
Except for the point where you get 99 levels in stealth, and then you basically break the game.
I think the reason for that is, though, it's because there's so much context to the world outside of being a thief.
That's true.
So it's like, you take that one avenue, and it's just like, I can be a thief, and there's so much context to everything else, that it makes what you're doing feel more...
I ended up being a thief on the side, because I was just like, I'd be like a noble warrior, but I would just like, just... Every town I went into, I would just automatically go into people's homes and take everything. And that wasn't my main job. Like, I joined the Thieves Guild. And basically, if you want to succeed in Skyrim, be a thief, because you'll never run out of money. In my first playthrough, I was like a warrior. And I think at most had 1,000 gold pieces, because I kept having to buy potions and stuff. I'm partway through my Thief like playthrough in this game. Now, obviously, I've done a lot more in this game. I've done a lot more of the side quests, but I have like 600,000 gold pieces. I have like so much gold. I'm just like, I can't even give it away quick enough. So I think I have something like 250 large health potions I'm just tracking around with me. I'm basically unkillable at this point.
Yeah, if you want to never die in Skyrim, be a thief and have a specialty as well in alchemy.
Yeah.
And you're going to be fine. But yeah, and likewise, I think it's...
Player.add-on.
I think it's often...
Player.beinvisible.
...more fun, I found, to be an assassin in Dishonored than it is to be an assassin in some of the Assassin's Creed games.
Yeah.
It's really depressing.
I actually think Assassin's Creed 1 pulled off the actual assassins a lot better. Assassinations better than the others. The others are very scripted events where you kill the guys.
Yeah.
In the first one, there's a cutscene setting up the dude in an area, and Altair's looking at him. Mm-hmm. And from there, the mission is go kill this guy.
Right.
I thought Assassin's Creed 2 did a better job with that because Assassin's Creed 2 didn't even give you the cutscene. It was just like the guy somewhere in the city, try and find them. And then they would be like, so you have to be like follow, you know, find out where he lives and then like distract the guards or kill them or like, you know,
run. Those are all like stuff. Set up missions though.
They're in objectives. Assassin's Creed 2, you get like an area on the map and you go in that area and use your eagle vision to single out the dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like sort of like.
How does Ezio know he's in this area?
Yeah,
that's true, I guess.
Right? In the first game, Altair goes through the city and does all these side missions that everybody hates. But he gets clues about where this guy is going to be at a certain time. And then the mission is, he goes there, sees the cutscene, sees the dude, physically sees him doing something.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, you're given free range as much as that game allowed to...
The first game was good for that. I think the second game and the further ones, but mostly the second game... Like
they're Skyrim infinitely better games.
Gives more context to that world. Like there's other elements outside of just tracking dudes down that makes the game feel more lively.
Oh, two plus are way better games than the first one, but I think the first one handled being an assassin better than the other ones.
I think the best experience. Sorry, go ahead, Em.
Well, I was just gonna say two is the first game I can remember where the like the pre-rendered trailer that they showed at E3 got me to buy the game, and then the game that basically got what game was it? I think it would have been Dead Island got me to believe, like made me realize, like, pre-rendered trailers aren't that great because, you know, they had this really awesome pre-rendered trailer for Dead Island, a game that ultimately wasn't that great.
Nope.
I was going to say, Assassin's Creed was the first and last game to have a pre-rendered trailer to make people buy games.
Yeah.
Trailer
was like 100 times better than the game.
Their trailers are always great. They have great music choice. For the most part, until they got into dubstep, then it's like, nope.
The best assassination experience I've ever had is still the Dark Brotherhood quest in Oblivion. I still think like the
whodunit quest. I think that's what it's
called. I mean, like the whole sequence of quests.
Oh yeah.
But you're thinking of the one in the mansion, right? Oh, that's amazing. But yeah, like
I think that's what it's called. I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, but the amount of discovery you had to do in that game to find, I think Aaron's right. The fact that it's a whole developed universe outside of just this, outside of just people killing other people.
Well, that was a lot of the fun, is because if you never had somebody telling you how to play the game.
Exactly.
It was all like you just happened upon it because. Mm-hmm. In a game like Assassin's Creed, that's the objective. That's what you're supposed to do, is like, you know, find this knife and then kill a guy with it and then run into somebody who's coming to the village you're in to kill you. Whereas in a game like Oblivion, you could completely miss that because you're doing something else.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah.
I think it's fantastic. A great approach, and well, I wish more game companies took advantage of it, but
it's unfortunate there are so many potato people in that game. And everybody has the same voice.
Yeah.
What's the problem with Skyrim has like 8 voice actors?
Yeah, it has the same
Skyrim
problem.
Has way more voice acting than
but it's still Oblivion like does. They recycle
a lot of voice actors.
Yeah,
especially for like the guards and stuff, where like they're like 3 voice actors for the guard. I mean, obviously that's a minor quibble against or a minor fault in an otherwise really like epic game, but you know.
Some of the best mods that you can get for Skyrim right now is one to hide the compass on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
It's still there. You just got to tap a button to make it come back.
Right, yeah.
But another one is It disables fast travel, so you're forced to use carts, or you can download a mod that puts way shrines around. So way shrines in the Dawnguard expansion, you know, the thing in the ground that you would go on, it's like a portal to another way shrine. So those are really cool. So those are scattered around. You go there and you can transport to another way shrine. So what that does is it means you actually have to walk places instead of being like all fast travel back to Whiterun, sell all this stuff, and then fast travel to wherever else I want.
And now
it forces the player to, I guess,
like, you know, think and explore.
Think and explore and remember where to go. Because without a compass, it's like, well, I can't remember where this fort is. I'll wander through this forest again until I find it, you know.
And maybe stumble across something.
Yeah.
Now, I don't... I'm not saying that... that's a really good point to make. There's too much hand-holding in video games. But you can go too far the other direction. Because, like, I've watched a video series that this guy did on the Ultima games. And especially the early ones, which came out in the 1980s. There was no hand-holding in that game. No. And, like, to the point where he was talking about, like, in order to beat the main... Like, the last boss of the game, you needed an item called the Quicksword. And you could only get in Ultima 3, you could only, in order to beat the final boss of that game, Exodus, you had to get a, what was it? I think you have to get a spaceship, fly to planet
X. This is a fantasy game, by the way.
Spaceship. Yeah. No, you'd, like, there are guys, like the blacksmith sells, like horse.
The blacksmith like, sells horse, spaceship.
Yeah, horse, cart, raft, boat, flying car, space shuttle. Like, that's in the menu for the...
How much for a spaceship? Oh, 2 iron bars, please.
you have to go to space.
We got about a minute and a half. Just less than a minute and a half, by the way.
Okay, you gotta go to space. You gotta go to Planet X, which is not even on the in-game map. You gotta find it yourself. You gotta go to there. You gotta talk to one guy who hangs out under a tree. He'll give you his blessing. You gotta go back to Earth. You gotta talk to another guy. Give him a 500 gold pieces using an unscripted, like an unknown prompt in the key prompt in the game. He'll give you the magic ring, and then you need the magic ring to sell to get like a sword that you need to kill the main bad guy. Nobody ever says that's what you gotta do in the game. You would have to talk to literally every single person in that game in order to figure out what it is.
Yeah. And you still probably wouldn't figure it out.
Yeah.
Ultima 8 is for free on Origin right now. If you have an Origin.
I thought that was a fighting game.
Ultima 8?
Yeah.
I heard it's like, besides Ultima 9, the worst one in the series.
It's still a free game.
I guess, yeah.
Anything free is a good deal. My buddy Tree used to say that. It's still true.
We're going to punch you in the nuts for free.
Tree?
I think you might have come up with the perfect counterexample. Now, we're going to be cluing up the radio portion of the show. If you're listening to us in Radio Land, remember to go on to pixelsjunkies.ca, where you can find the full hour and a half long video version and uncensored version of the podcast.
Or iTunes, or various iTunes, other things. Or on Twitter YouTube, and all or, that.
Find us on Twitter and on Facebook, and we will communicate with you.
Bye.
Bye.
You are now listening to the Pixel Junkies podcast after show. Welcome back.
We're not going to have headphones anymore.
They were stolen. So there are three, like, rooms in this studio. Studios in this place where we record, and we only have one adapter for some reason at the moment, because, I don't know, someone made off the other one, I guess. And, so the guys, I gave the
There's one right there on the table. I'm assuming that doesn't work.
No, it doesn't work. That needs another adapter. That needs one of the adapters for this one.
Oh, it is just perfect. Yeah.
And,
even really, because is it, like, large enough to fit two adapters in it?
You'd have to angle them a certain way, but so I gave it to the guys doing the live show right now.
Does that split stereo channel?
Sorry?
Does that split the channel, like, from stereo to mono?
No, just for two headphones.
Oh,
that would work. And, I figure it's more important that they have the sound proper for their live version.
We should probably invest in getting one of those $5 things.
We have one. It's on attached to your pair of headphones, right?
Oh, yeah.
All you gotta do is bring them.
We should probably start bringing that to the thing that we do every Friday.
So we came up with a nickname for Andrew.
No! Yes, no, we did not! Because yes, it's terrible. No. It's so bad.
So if Aaron's bagel, then Aaron's cream, then Andrew's cream cheese.
Andrew the cream cheese Blake. I like it. It'll stick, pardon the pun. That wasn't supposed to be a gay joke. It was just like cream cheese is.
I'm pretty sure cream cheese is a pretty gay joke.
No, I meant like because I'm bagel. It'd be kind of gay. Yeah, I just meant that cream cheese is sticky.
That's what I thought you meant.
Yeah. Don't worry. Yeah, good, good. You got a solid mind, Rory. So, Batman or something. I don't know what you were getting on with.
Yeah, so for... Well, did we talk about the Joker?
Speaking of cream cheese.
Oh, no, we didn't talk about
it. We didn't.
All right, so we now know what Joker is possibly going to look like, and we know what...
It'd be cool, except for that tattoo on his head.
We know what Ben Affleck's going to look like. They came out and said that Joker is not going to have tattoos in the movie.
Good, because they're horrible.
But... Why was there a press photo of him with all those tattoos?
Yeah, we don't, like, let's also, gauge like, the reaction. Is he not going to, like... I presume he's going to wear a shirt the whole movie, so presumably we wouldn't see the tattoos.
I assume that the purple glove was his, like, oh, well, this is a Joker, we got to have something purple, so let's give him a purple glove for some reason, Michael Jackson style.
By the way, I totally agree with Aaron about the Batman photo. It does look like he's about to cry.
He's like... And he has no neck either, so he's like...
I don't think he looks that bad.
I don't think he looks bad at all. I think he looks great, but I still think that picture makes him look like he's about to cry.
Oh, yeah, yeah. From the Kingdom Come comic. That's where Ben Affleck got his...
By Mark Waid and Alex Ross.
His, his inspiration. He definitely has no neck. That cannot be argued. There's literally no neck on that Batman. And, I don't know, he just has like a bit of Mona Lisa look about him, where the more you look at him, the more pouty he looks. And the white underneath his eyes, in just the right way, looks like tears. Like, he's starting to swell up.
That's what really, I think, swayed me over to your
Well, his causes. Power suit is basically the power suit from The Dark Knight Returns, isn't it?
Oh. I haven't seen that movie.
How's there not a picture of this on Google?
Yeah. Just look up Ben Affleck, like, Sookie or something, and guaranteed it's the first one.
Because it won't come up Geely or whatever.
Ben Affleck Pout.
Geely is the film you're thinking of.
Oh, no. This is just Ben Affleck having sex with Sookie.
Ben Affleck Pout. Let's see what we get. Hold on, viewers.
We should bring this up on the video.
Keep scrolling.
Or maybe not. That might be too much work. I don't
Scroll.
Know.
It's got to be on here.
This is just a lot of Ben Affleck.
Yeah, there's no Batman. There. All right, I'm right. Also, none of them are pouts.
Anyway, it seems to be the suit from Batman Returns.
Is it?
I think so.
Oh. Also, the one thing that drove me nuts about that photo is his cape, where his cape attaches to his like armor thing, is offset from his
or Dark Knight face. Returns, not Batman Returns.
It's like
yeah, I was confused for a second.
It's off to the right a little bit, and it's really like. Like, why couldn't you just center it?
So, there's a thing on IGN that says this week's top 5 must-see GTA mods, and the picture they showed for it was an exploding humpback whale.
Alright.
Why is this so hard to find on Google?
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, there's a new... The guys who made Banjo-Kazooie are making a new game called...
Yeah, I heard about that.
That's the action figure.
It's Kickstarter.
Oh, yeah.
Jesus.
So I'm looking forward to that. That looks like a cool game.
His entire chest is literally a Batman logo, and it's not even like a bat anymore. It's just like someone threw black paint at him.
Yeah, but see, I'm not opposed to it. I
really like the new photo. I like it a lot.
The new.
I haven't
Ben
seen
Affleck.
It.
Wait, hold on.
You haven't seen Ben Affleck as Batman? We posted it too.
Apparently, the images.
Yeah, but you post so much. Wait. Shit.
This is
it's all super relevant, Adam.
So anyways, I was on this I'm on this website here and they mentioned they had some images and they're like Superman. Images have been removed at the request of Warner Brothers. Are some of the images being retracted?
There's no way they can be. It's all over the internet now.
Well, I know they can't be successfully retracted, but I just thought it was interesting because they had this photo mostly blocked out and they mentioned later on. Now it could be just that could be something else. I know
there was a color one that they got rid of.
This has to be the most random thing I've ever seen on IGN. And that's saying a lot, considering it's IGN.
It's just like we browse
Tortoise
the internet.
Mauled by rat gets legs replaced by wheels.
Interesting.
What's the context?
Nothing, it's just on their newsfeed.
Alright, so what else happened this week? Silent Hills got cancelled.
Oh, yeah. Because Studio Kojima.
It's not Kojima, it's Konami that's...
I guess that's way better than the one that...
Kojima has nothing to do with why it's getting cancelled, presumably.
Kojima and Konami must have had, like, a colossal falling out. Or fight, or something.
Some people are now saying it's a giant conspiracy about Metal Gear.
What?
No. I disagree.
Silent Hills is...
That's like breaking the fifth wall. It's like, let's close down this entire business for some inside joke about Metal Gear Solid.
Breaking the fifth wall must be like making reference jokes to like God.
Interstellar.
What?
Interstellar.
But he was in a room with only four walls at the end. A giant corridor thing. Four walls.
No, what about the wall? Ceiling and the floor?
No ceiling or floor in that room.
Yeah, because it just went forever. Whatever. Let's move on. It got canceled. No more Norman Reedus. I'm okay with that.
You don't like Norman Reedus?
I like Norman Reedus. I think.
Did you ever see Boondock Saints?
I think he. No. I think I.
Was he in that?
I don't hate the guy. Yeah. I just hate The Walking Dead.
Oh, yeah.
Why do you hate The Walking Dead, Aaron?
It's such a shitty show.
I rarely do this and come to the defense of Aaron's negative opinion.
Please.
With,
do you like The Walking Dead?
I what?
You like The Walking Dead?
No, I do not. And now, mind you,
good job, cream cheese.
I really wanted to like it, right?
Yeah.
Because as some I say, salty as a critic, cream cheese. I want to like everything. I don't like it. It's for a similar reason that I don't like Breaking Bad. Not that they're similar shows, but it's for the same reason. They're not the same show, but they both.
You
shows,
had them up to that point.
Both shows had an ideal. And they committed entirely to that ideal. It's just, it wasn't a style that appealed to me.
Where you're wrong is The Walking Dead had one idea.
Where you're wrong is everything.
Walking Dead had one idea, and Breaking Dead...
Breaking Dead. Good
Breaking
show.
Bad had several ideas. Several yes. good ideas.
Okay, yeah. No, yeah, but they both committed wholly, and neither were styles and narratives that really appealed to me.
No, and that's fair. You know, I'm not going to hate on, you know, not for not liking the show. I just feel like The Walking Dead doesn't have any variety. It's just like, all right, here's this entire season. We get this one idea. Like any other show, but The Walking
Aaron
Dead...
Aaron only watched season two.
I watched season one entirely. I watched half of season two, which I tried three times
that's
to get
what
through.
That's
I got halfway through the season, and I was like, fuck this. I got to the bit with the girl in the bar, and I was like, no, I'm done. I don't care anymore. This is like... Six episodes of finding this one girl. It should have been one episode.
Season two is really rough. The seasons past that, I enjoyed a lot.
Okay, so
it gets significantly better.
I always find in shows like
season
that.
Season three was shit too, though.
I like season like that two. Would like
I'm the bad guy, bye! All right, season four.
With Game of Thrones or Walking Dead, shows where that have a rotating, like a very fluid cast and where any character is able to die at the drop of a hat... I always find that, like, I get really emotionally connected to the wrong characters, and I'm like, I love this character, and then...
But and you're then getting getting tricked by the shows, because they want you to feel bad when those characters
Yeah, I think
die.
That's the idea.
They yeah. trick you into liking those characters a lot right before they die.
Yeah.
But they also do a good job of not just setting up, like, because that's sort of where The Walking Dead gets a little predictable, is there's like, oh, let's give this character an entire episode. It's like, all right, well, they're going to die, because, you know, I didn't care about them before now.
Yeah.
But with Game of Thrones, it's like the whole season is building up every character, so you're not sure who's going to...
You know what's a better version of The Walking Dead? Falling
the Game?
Falling Sky?
Yeah, Falling Sky is actually...
Is it Falling Sky or Falling Skies? I never know.
Falling Skies.
Okay, yeah.
It's actually really good. It's about,
I haven't seen it.
It's about aliens invading, and it's like 3 months... So the aliens rolled in, wiped out most of all of Earth's defenses mainly, and then left a token garrison force to kind of harvest the rest of humanity. So, like, before, humanity had no chance because they were simply outnumbered, like, 100-1. Now they have more of a chance, but they don't have any jets, they don't have any tanks, they barely have any, like, firearms left, and it's just about a group of survivors trying to, like, kind of, you know, keep together and survive, and they have to split up, and, like, the aliens still, like, have superior technology to them, but they're, like, a ragtag resistance. Really good show. I've seen the first season, and I've been meaning to buy the second season and the third season and, you know, watch them, because it is actually a really good show.
My favorite part of the Battlestar Galactica series is that part of the series when they're on that planet they decide to settle on.
Was it New Caprica?
It was New Caprica,
Never so.
Where they get taken over, but well, the Cylons come down and kind of take over, and then there's a resistance.
I
on
like
that planet. That was my favorite.
My favorite part
of the
is the part after that. But yes, one of my favorite parts is the recoil of that happens after.
Okay, yeah.
But I think that
I gotta be honest.
Yeah,
I preferred Because I really did like Battlestar Galactica, but in terms of that kind of a sci-fi show that's more military-like and with more of an overarching plot, I prefer both Deep Space Nine and Babylon 5 to it, because I feel like they're... I don't like shows that's just, you know, serious all the time. Like,
there's no comic relief in BSG.
Like, I my ideal show is a show like Firefly or Angel, where it's serious and then funny, and then serious then funny.
My problem with comic relief is it becomes predictable.
Depends upon how you do it. Star Trek doesn't make it predictable. They just sort of...
But it's not even comic relief. There's just light, happy moments in that show, which you do not get in Battlestar Galactica. And you rarely get in Game of Thrones. Probably. And I don't think you ever get in Walking Dead.
They're funny.
One of the issues I have with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But they're not enough for me.
And I get that's me. I'm not saying that... I've never said that Game of Thrones is a bad show. It's just not, like... It's not one of my... It's not an ideal show for me.
The thing for me, ultimately, about Walking Dead is what we were saying earlier about Thief. Is that I feel like that kind of stuff is done in a way that appeals to me more in other shows. Like, in Game of Thrones, right? The zombie thing in Game of Thrones is much better for me than the zombie thing in Walking Dead. I know they're not zombies in Game of Thrones. Close enough.
Yeah, close enough.
Because it's a more well-developed universe, and they can take breaks from it.
Yeah, it's not like there's one thing after the other. It's like, you know, let's just do this one thing for five seasons.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like... You get the way that Game of Thrones is done is there's so many characters that instead of, like, bombarding you with, like, here's 2 minutes of this character, here's 2 minutes of this character, is, like, every second episode has a different set of characters and what they're doing at that time.
That is a problem with Walking Dead, I will admit. If all the episodes focus on this one group of characters all the time, if you don't like one of those characters, you're not going to like the show.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, in Game of Thrones, you'll get, like, 20 minutes of what Arya's doing... 20 minutes of what Sansa's doing.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, the other 20 minutes is, like, in King's Landing somewhere. And then the next episode has a different set of things going on.
Let me ask you, at this point in the series, Game of Thrones, do you feel like...
Don't say anything about the new season. I haven't seen it.
Okay.
Do you feel that any of the characters are safe at this point? I feel like Arya and Jon in particular are safe for the series. At least for a while.
For now, I think they are because,
like, they're
presumably Khaleesi or Daenerys.
Don't say anything at all about the new season.
I'm only halfway up there. Like,
I know, but I don't want you to say something and then to them to sort of semi deny it, and there to be this dynamic.
Well,
where at least
I feel Daenerys isn't going to go anywhere either.
Yeah,
or Tyrion. I feel like we've got a cast of characters now that. We started off with a huge cast, and now we're down to just a few.
Yeah.
I feel like these guys are meant to be the main characters of this.
It's like Big Brother, but less vicious and bloodthirsty.
These aren't spoilers, because these are
not nearly as good.
No.
These are just what I'm thinking.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I think there's like a couple characters that seem like they have like storylines going on that the show wants to get to in order to do something else. But I feel like that could sort of start and resolve by the end of the season. Like, I don't know if Tyrion's really safe. Like, maybe mid-season or end of season. Like, I don't know what's going on with him.
Well, I mean, he could easily just die from, like, just, like... Because Game of Thrones is one of the few shows where characters can just die. Like, he could just be riding along and take an arrow, like, from nowhere. And, like, they would be okay for that show. But if a show like Star Trek did it, where all of a sudden, like, Picard... ate a phaser to the face and just died. Like, yeah. That wouldn't be acceptable, you know?
Well, Game of Thrones, like, established very early on that, you know, the hero is going to...
The hero
is not invincible.
Yeah, the hero died, spoiler alert, his name is Boromir.
If there's something, like, if there's something wrong with the character, like, he's deformed whatsoever, or is, you know, crippled, or is, you know...
Yeah.
He's safe. He's the hero of the thing. If you've got...
Or if you have dragons...
Yeah, if you're like, if you're the stereotypical, you know, like, action hero sort of guy, you're probably going to die.
So basically, Conan the Barbarian would have had his balls chopped off and his arm lopped off, and he would have been.
I would love to have a crossover where Conan just comes in and wrecks shit.
That's entirely true, though. The game sort of does mix it up a bit in that respect.
He ends up marrying.
You saw the last season,
right?
I saw the last season.
The whole last season?
Yes, the entirety of the last season, but Adam has not.
Okay, well.
It's been so spoiled for me, I don't even care at this point.
Like, the mountain is still going up. Like, he's still around. And he's, like, the first guy that should have been killed in any other action. Pieces of him are. Okay. But he's still alive. The show definitely favors underdogs, but that doesn't mean they're invincible. It just sort of sets them up, you know? Like, I would consider Arya and Daenerys as, like, the two main characters of that show.
Okay, that's acceptable.
Just because Daenerys, like, seems to have her own, like, sort of underarching, like, this is eventually going to be the main storyline.
Oh, yeah. It totally doesn't do the Friends thing where there's no main character at any given time. There are definitely main characters at any given time.
At least it is now. Back in the first season, or in the second season, I don't think it was... Because the first season, the main character was...
Ned?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
But in the second season...
They get a little more ambiguous in the
second season. And then I think it took them a while to reestablish.
Third, I think.
But, you know. It's definitely right now, like, Arya and Daenerys, and you can make an argument for Tyrion.
Yeah. I think Tyrion is safe in terms of dying.
They've been
accurate
in terms of their first billing.
I think a lot of bad stuff is going to happen to him in the near future.
Oh, God, yes. But it's Game of Thrones. I mean, it's expected. Yes.
Well, he seems to be, like, the only one at this point, apart from Arya a little bit, to be toying with, like, morality and where he is. Like, he seems to sort of be safe in the direction he's going, but he, like, it's not really a spoiler. He seems to sort of be... less caring about his situation.
I don't think he's safe at all after the very end of the last episode.
No, yeah, exactly. So, I don't know. They're not spoilers.
We're teasing
thin
you.
Thin ice, Andrew.
We're teasing you. Watch the episodes.
Yeah, I know.
The man with that
elephant. How many have they done now? Five?
Four?
Three.
I think three are out.
Oh, okay, so they haven't caught up to the leak yet.
No.
No.
That's why I haven't watched the leaks, because it's like, well, I'll watch them all now. I still got to wait like
that's
a
the
month
problem.
And a half to get to anything right.
Yeah.
I have a show recommendation for you that I think you'd really like. It's called... It's an old show called Space Above and Beyond. You ever heard of it?
Nope.
It lasted for exactly one season, kind of.
I'm surprised you haven't heard of it.
Yeah.
one season maybe run.
Maybe I have heard of it.
It's kind of like, it's about this squadron of cadets who, aliens attack Earth, and, like, they have to, like, they end up, they're kind of a mix between pilots and Marines, and they end up having just to, like, protect the Earth in various missions and stuff, but it's actually really well done.
When was it made? How old?
Christ, 93, probably.
Oh, okay, 93. Okay, so an acceptable time to make a space thing.
Yeah.
okay, good.
The CGI is so primitive, it's actually hilarious. But, like, keep in mind that it was made in 92.
Yeah. See, but I've said this before, I don't think that's just an excuse. Not really.
I mean, it was bad at the time.
Yeah.
It was really bad at the time. So it was Battlestar. Bear in mind,
it's also... not a movie, it's television.
Yeah.
Television special
effects. But they have practical effects as well that are really good.
Okay.
But there are some CG stuff, and you're just like...
If it's bad at the time, there's no excuse. No. You should have done it without it.
But to be fair, it didn't really have a budget.
Yeah,
but I think back in the 90s, it was possible to be too ambitious with what you were trying to do.
That's true.
And they because they got canceled.
If we did this with stop motion, it would look terrible. If we did it with CG, it would look terrible. If we did it with practical effects, it would cost millions. So,
you know what
would
look pretty good? I saw footage that they made for Jurassic Park, the first one. Spoilers for you, Rory, because, you know.
I watched a bit of it and then stopped caring about it.
Why? It's a good movie.
Apparently.
It's a really good movie.
I'm sure it is. I just didn't have the patience. I was a kid.
Did
I
you see how they made that
Star Wars again?
Did you see how they made that first scene with, like, the dinosaur or whatever it is, the Brachiosaurus, massive
Brachiosaurus.
Whatever, man. Dinosaur would.
Aaron doesn't care about dinosaurs.
I only care about
Bryce Dallas Howard.
But yeah,
that was a weird look.
It was supposed to be. It was literally a photo on a green screen. Like, that scene where you see the dinosaurs coming up out of the water is literally a photo. It's not even video. It's just like, oh, this is crap.
I'll tell you what I'll do. I do like movies. I will sit down and watch it again. I'm sure it is good.
But they got a guy that when they were thinking, it was right very early production. They hadn't even started shooting it yet.
Yeah.
And they had to make the critical decision of whether they were going to use CG for the big, you know, the wide angle shots with the dinosaurs, or if they were going to use stop motion. And the guy did a test for stop motion with the velociraptors running, and then he did one with a T-Rex running. And, like, I'm glad they went with CG, because it ultimately holds up better in the long run, but the stop motion was still really good.
Yeah.
So props to that guy for doing that. He did probably as best a job as you could have done with stop motion.
Stop motion can look very good.
Yeah, definitely.
And I think it holds up to the test of time better than CGI does.
Except
if it's done properly.
Yeah. Terminator didn't.
No.
Jesus.
Or Jason and the Argonauts. God.
I like the skeletons in that. I thought they were done very well.
They're kind of done well. A movie with really good stop motion.
They look stupid when they're moving, but I think it adds to the creepiness factor of skeletons moving around.
Yeah, that's true.
They're very janky.
I watched
probably move too fast though.
I watched a couple of months ago a childhood movie I hadn't seen in a while called. It was back when Disney stopped making cartoons and were starting to make a lot more live action stuff called. It's called Bedknobs and Broomsticks. Can't remember what the life of me for the plot
bed is. Knobs?
Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
Not yeah, much Aaron, better. Bedknobs. Duh.
I think it's Bedknobs and Broomsticks. And there's a scene at the end where Germans attack England, and so they have to use magic in order to defend.
It is bedknobs.
Yeah.
What the fuck is a bedknob?
It's a knob in your bed.
No, it's, you know, when you get, like, wooden frames around beds?
It's another name for morning wood. You get a bedknob.
Anyway, they animate a bunch of suits of armor to go attack the Germans, and the Germans are firing machine guns at them, and they have to, but they're just animated suits of armor, so they, like, take off their boots and shake the bullets out.
Yeah, it's not a word. Yeah. There's no definition for it on the internet.
Yeah, but what is supposed to be?
I just said the definition.
So that must be like a thing specific to that movie. Like a bed knob is like a creature or something.
Sure, I don't even care. It doesn't matter.
It's like Toy Stories, except
you
the toys are
is?
Sex
you
toys.
Know what it is? It's Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. Huh. That's what it is.
Sex Toy Stories.
Hey, I remember that movie.
We love
Chitty Chitty
Bang Bang. Chitty Bang Bang. Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
It was alright.
But Chitty Chitty Bang
Bang. It had its moments.
It's very old.
Never saw it.
You know it's a pretty good movie to watch? The original King Kong, like the 1920s King Kong. That's actually pretty funny.
I actually quite like the Peter Jackson version.
I liked it too. It dragged a bit.
Yes, it did.
The only part that was wrong was the part where the T-Rex lost the fight, but besides that, it was good. And by T-Rex, I mean V-Rex, because that's their official name.
Yeah.
Because... Although it makes sense, because really, the idea that T-Rexes wouldn't have evolved to something else in this enclosed environment for 65 million years is absurd.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Yeah, how come they weren't humans?
What, the T-Rex turned evolved into humans?
We don't have enough...
Yeah, why not?
Giant humans?
I don't have enough time in the universe to explain why you're wrong.
Well, they turned into V-Rexes.
It should have been a giant, like, crow sort of bird thing.
Also, no.
Why?
Why? Because birds split off from dinosaurs like much earlier, probably partway through the Jurassic period.
Okay, well, some sort of other thing, except you know, not just the slightly different.
What it should have been is should have been a smaller T Rex, because there's no way that three hyper large. It's no way that a group of hyper large carnivores could live on this island, not completely.
Yeah, they would have been inbred to the point of being like. Four heads.
If they should have been a T-Rex with banjos.
Like,
they should have been a
tail coming out of its neck and stuff.
It should have been a lot smaller just because the oxygen content in the atmosphere has dropped a lot since the Jurassic period.
That's not true. Cretaceous had similar oxygen levels to... Don't try and beat me on that.
Yeah, dumbass.
that's why plants were much larger back
then. Yeah, but that doesn't matter. Like, plants is only one part of the reason why dinosaurs got so big.
Yeah, but dinosaurs were larger.
I love this argument.
Maybe it should have been some aquatic animal. Some sort of, like, fish dinosaur thing. I don't know.
Can I point out something? Back in the Matthew Broderick Godzilla movie.
Which I actually liked.
Okay.
No, you didn't.
There's a scene where they're talking about the footprint.
Yep.
And there's one woman, she's like, she's a paleontologist, and she's like... What made this footprint? She's like, some sort of Allosaurus or another dinosaur that died out during the Cretaceous period. And I'm just like, no! Dinosaurs never got that big to the point where we're at the point where the cube square law should be taking effect and this thing shouldn't be able to move. But whatever. That always bugged me. But
yeah, too much oxygen that we don't have in our atmosphere.
But the new Godzilla is even bigger. Explain that one.
You can't. So just ignore it.
New Godzilla movie is awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's good enough that you can be like, fuck it. Don't care.
I saw it. Okay, I only saw it once. But it was really good. I had a lot of fun.
Godzilla makes sense.
I was going to say I saw it twice, but I think Adam saw it twice.
I saw it twice.
Okay, that was it. Okay, yeah.
Did you guys not like the Matthew Broderick Godzilla?
I never watched it. I don't really like Godzilla ordinarily that much.
It didn't need that shitty love story wedged into it. It's like, yeah. I don't care about Matthew Broderick. I don't care about his blonde chick.
Also, you know what else?
Just show freaking Godzilla.
The Lost Raptor scenes from Jurassic Park. It didn't need them either.
No. It was a very stupid movie. I still enjoyed it. It was an entertaining
movie. You
know what
was much better? The animated series that came out after.
Never watched it.
It was it's all on YouTube. You should watch it. It's actually really good. You know, for
and the helicopter chase. You're like, we lost the T signatures. Like, how? How the hell did you? It's the size of a building. It's like, oh, it's gone. Well, guess we should go back to base.
It's colder than the building.
It must be hiding inside of a building. You know what building is larger than Godzilla? No building. No building is larger than Godzilla. I can't physically hide in a building.
And then the music gets really still quiet. Movie, and nobody talks, and all
bad
of a sudden,
movie.
Oh, jump scare!
I love the part where they blew up the Chrysler Building. It's like it's colder than the buildings around us. And what the hell were you locked on? Did you not see the little icon being like, you're locked on to the Chrysler Building? You still want to? It's like you might want to consider not fire the missiles. All right.
I think he's in that building, sir. He's clearly over there. Blow the hell out of that building.
Bike. Also, you know the scene where he's eating the fish and they all got they're all lined up to shoot him and then they shoot at him and Godzilla's strategy to avoid all the bullets is to duck and it works and they're just like, sir, he's ducking, what do we do? Continue to fire at the same place.
Why contrast the scene with the, whatever they were, F-22s in the new Godzilla movie when the, whatever they call them, Mutos. Did their EMP thing, and then the jets just shut down, and they, like, exploded into the ground. It was probably the best scene in that movie, I think.
It's one of the few times I've ever gotten chills sitting in a movie theater, like goosebumps all down my body, was when the Muto's about to eat the guy, and then all the, out on the core, you just see something blue, like, springing to life, and you see it's his tail, and I'm like, it's the nuclear breath. I legitimately got chills the first time, but I think I had a minor freak out.
Quite possibly.
Yeah. I also had a minor freak out in Avengers.
Yeah, no kidding.
Twice.
Yeah.
Did Godzilla use his nuclear breath?
Well, he did, yeah.
Avengers versus Godzilla.
He was actually... Marvel used to own the rights to the Godzilla comics, so there's like... There's a really funny scene where he's trying to push over a building and Thor's holding up the other end, so they're both pushing on the building and it's not falling over.
I've gotten used to Adam's minor freakout in theaters ever since in the 11th grade we saw Transformers 2 and he had a freakout about seeing some sort of Transformer. I'm like, what's that thing? And Adam's like, yeah, it's, I don't know, whatever the hell,
probably Jetfire,
a Tron or probably. Whatever it was.
I feel like cool. Godzilla versus any, like, Iron Man in particular wouldn't work. Because he could just fly off his nostril and blow up his brain.
I like the idea of Thor holding up a building, and then whatever he's holding on to, presumably a window, is strong enough to hold up the whole building. Like,
I'll just hold up this building with a window. In Pacific Rim, when the thing, like, picks up a boat and, like, swings it at something, I'm like, it's a boat. Like, there's no, like...
That's
boat
a damn well-designed vessel right there,
like,
man.
The boat should have...
swung it like he's holding it like this, and then he brings it in the combat position of the rest of the boat.
You can't swing a boat.
When he's dragging the boat, it's like, okay, that's kind of whatever. When as soon as he picks up the boat, the thing should have just, like, fallen into, like...
Exactly, you can't pick up a boat. It can't happen.
And then not only does he do that and swing it, but he hits the thing, the whatever the frig they're called... Kaijus 7,000 times and then throws it down a road and then it just bounces end over end like comical GTA physics and wedges itself between two buildings.
Unbelievably durable.
That's like one part of the movie where I was like, I'm done with this.
Not if like that whole...
No.
Oh, I really liked it.
Maybe that whole thing was like solid steel inside. There was very little actual cargo space inside that thing.
What would have made that movie better was if it was just robots. No people involved at all. Just robots fighting monsters.
You should check out the movie RoboJack.
Or Atlantic Rim.
One thing I will say about Charlie Hunnam is he's totally avoided the casting thing. He's totally avoided typecasting so much that I don't know what roles... I would cast him in if I was a casting person. Like, he was the lead in Sons of Anarchy, and he was...
I was going to ask, what has he been?
The guy in Pacific Rim, just like, what does that guy play? I don't know what role to put him in. Recommend,
he plays,
like, you'd be good in this. Like,
there's nobody interesting.
He plays the guy
in Pacific
Rim.
There's
nobody interesting. I like the girl.
Animal Chow was really interesting.
I thought she did a good job. She did a good job.
Yeah, but she wasn't enough to hold up the whole movie. Like, she was just like some character who had no dialogue. Ron Perlman.
He was good.
Who had three lines in the whole movie. And for some reason, I'm just picturing Hellboy being in that movie.
I like
that's because it's Ron Perlman.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just, oh, okay. I'm you're literally just like
Hellboy.
He's literally just Hellboy. Ron Perlman's awesome. Why am I in this movie?
I like Charlie Day. He was wasted in that movie, but
he shouldn't have been a scientist. It was stupid. And then the other guy was like, they were basically like the Muppets, like those two scientist Muppets guy.
Thing? Yeah, I didn't like
Charlie Day's the shorter guy, and then the really annoying fake German guy.
Dr. Benson Honeydew and Beaker.
Yeah, there you go. Those two guys in Pacific Rim. And then who else was in it? Some guy who had his brother killed. I don't care.
Wasn't Idris Elba in Pacific
Rim? Yeah, he was good. I liked him too.
Yeah. Idris Elba's quite good.
He's good in a
lot. Should have just been robots.
If he wasn't Heimskul, I would have him.
I think he was one of the best characters in
Prometheus. Honestly, would have had him as
War Machine. Yes, he definitely was.
And not Heimskul.
Yet another example of how, even if Michael Fassbender's in a movie that a lot of people don't like, they never complain about his performance.
Heimdall.
I think we're cloning up the show now. Thanks very much for staying tuned in.
Thank you very much for listening to the show and watching it on YouTube. Please come back again next Monday and check out the next episode. We'll be having a more...
Go see the Avengers, because we'll probably spoil it next week.
Oh, yeah, it's getting spoiled to hell next week. So. Yeah,
we'll have a more in-depth discussion of the Avengers, for sure. Because...
Iron Man dies.
And Andrew will have seen
I will
it.
Also entail...
And Jordan, if he's here, will have also seen it.
Maybe not.
Bagel and cream cheese out.